Words are very powerful. And today my prayer is that words that have been spoken over you will be broken off you that were not from God. As I was studying the fivefold ministry and the passages in Psalm 68 and Ephesians chapter 2, Ephesians 4, different places, 1 Corinthians 12, and getting a handle saying, God, what is your purpose and how can we help? We've had a number of churches come and say, we want to model the church after what we see happening in your church. It's an apostolic model. And Peter Wagner had asked me to be part of a council of 12 to start an association of apostolic churches. So we've met with different people and talked about it. But it was interesting, in Ephesians 4, in the middle of verses 7 to 16, it says, in speaking the truth in love. Speaking the truth in love causes us to be built up and grow up. See, the enemy's plan is to lie, to speak lies in hate to destroy your life. But Jesus' purpose is to speak the truth in love. And God's word is very powerful. I mean, God's word is so powerful. It says in Isaiah 55, verses 11, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. And it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. So speaking God's word, believing God's word, meditating on God's word is really what sets people free. When you align yourself, you need to get out of the line of listening to the devil's lies, maybe lies that parents or teachers or aunts or uncles or professors or people that were your boss spoke, and you stood in that line and listened to lies. You need to get out of that line and get in alignment in God's line and begin to let God's truth transform your life. You replace the lies with God's truth, and you refuse to receive lies. Hebrews 4:12 says, for the word of God is quick, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It divides and pierces asunder the joints and the marrow, and the soul and the spirit, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. So they've been ministering the word of God in Philippines. We've been ministering the word of God to people for many years, and you know what? The truth sets people free. It's the truth that sets people free. When people are bound, when people are struggling, as you declare the truth over their life, and you know what? You tell them, you know what? I've told people, I'm going to refuse to allow you to believe lies. I'm going to stand in your corner like a corner man, and you know what I'm going to say? I'm going to say, the devil's a liar. I said, get up your guard and punch him with Hebrews 4:12, and then give him a left hook with Isaiah 55:11. And then take out Ephesians 4:12 and speak the truth in love that he's a defeated foe, that yeah, he knocked you down, but you're going to knock him out. And the Lord's already knocked him out. And we need to get in each other's corner and declare the truth. Jesus said, now are you clean through the word that I have spoken unto you. In Proverbs 18:21, Song of Solomon, it's not the Song of Solomon, but Proverbs, but Solomon, who wrote Song of Solomon and Proverbs, said there's death and life in the power of the tongue. So what you speak is really manifesting what's in your heart. And I want to encourage you, be careful what you speak to yourself. The most important sermon you will hear all week is the message you're speaking to yourself at work, at home, and all those things. And you need to make sure that you're speaking to yourself the truth in love. So let's look at Hebrews chapter 10, verses 26. The first verse, probably none of you have put to memory. It's probably not in your memory verse, red box card that you get out every morning. For if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there is no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful expectation of judgment and fiery indignation which will devour the adversaries. Anyone who has rejected Moses' law dies without mercy. On the testimony of two or three witnesses, of how much worse punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, counted the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified a common thing, and insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord, and again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But recall the former days in which, after you were illuminated, you endured a great struggle with sufferings, partly while you were made a spectacle, both by reproaches and tribulations, and partly while you became companions of those who were so treated. For you had compassion on me in my chains and joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a better and an enduring possession for yourselves in heaven. Therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe in the saving of the soul. Father, take your word, quicken it to people's hearts, And I pray the words that are spoken, that the word that comes from your mouth will proceed out of the mouth and hit the target of each person's heart. I pray you draw a bullseye on each heart, Holy Spirit, today, and you would cause the arrow of your word to hit the target in whatever area they need. And I pray that your word will release them to a new freedom of life. I thank you that there's life in the power of our tongue to release life everywhere we go. And Lord, you said, now are you clean through the word that has been spoken. I pray that people will be cleansed. You said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So I pray as your word goes forth that the truth will set people free from bondages and word curses that have been spoken over them, because your word is powerful. Lord, your word can transform people, and they don't need 39 weeks of 7-hour seminars and 199.95 tapes to be delivered. You can speak the word and they can be delivered instantly by the power and the presence of God. And as they endure to receive their promise, I thank you that you can give them strength to endure in Jesus' name. Amen. The first 6 verses are really words of warning. I am so thankful that God is still a God that warns us. In an age when most people just want to tell people good news and sweet things and nice things, I'm glad that the Word of God tells us the truth. It says that we need to be careful. There was a warning given in Timothy that in the last days people are going to want to have itching ears. They're only going to want to hear speakers that tickle them and tell them what they want to hear. And he said, be careful, because we're living in an age of lawlessness. I love what one man said, what lawlessness is. If you study the Greek word lawlessness, eventually it means there will be no more laws for good people. Laws will only be made to protect evil people. That's lawlessness. It's already happening. I'm in Bartels last night with my wife after we did some things. And while we're in Bartels, I remember the last time we were in there was a man that had been in there and had been stealing stuff. And the manager came up. Well, I was right behind him. She said, sir, we've had you on cameras. You've been stealing many things over a number of months, and we're letting you know if you come in here again, we're putting your pictures in all the Bartels, we will call the police and you will be arrested. And so this guy opens his coat and he starts pulling out, I mean, just like lots of stuff. And I'm like, and so I was in there, and I saw the same lady there, not the manager, but I said, do people steal stuff? She said, oh, you wouldn't believe all the stuff that gets stolen in the stores. And she said, the crazy thing is we really can't arrest them, or you can be polite to them, but you can't tell them. You know, they actually tell people don't have them arrested, or they might attack the people. So it's lawlessness, and they're more protected because, you know, they have rights as a thief. I mean, I remember a few years ago when a man was robbing an elementary school, and he walked through the skylight and fell through and got hurt, and he sued the school and won a $1.2 million settlement because there was a skylight on the roof. It's craziness. But I'll tell you, God is a just judge. And yes, God is a loving God, and yes, God is a merciful God, but God is a holy God, and God is a just God, and we're not preaching enough preachers. A lot of preachers are just telling people what they want to hear and tell them about, you know, grace and love and mercy. But you know what? One day, everybody I talk to is going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. They're either going to stand before the white throne judgment, or they're going to stand before the Bema seat. My goal is that every person I speak to will one day stand before the Bema seat. We will be judged for every word that we speak. We will be judged for everything that we do. And you cannot be a ruler, and the word ruler is synonymous with judging. You can't be a judge without ruling. And, you know, people have tried to make God into something he's not. God is a holy God, and God is the judge. And Jesus Christ will be the man that God will judge every person by. So there's a word of warning here. It says, if we willfully sin. It says, if we willfully sin. He wasn't picking on anybody in particular, but he was saying in this time of great persecution they were in, we need to be careful. He was saying, he was warning them, he said, in this willful sin, if you study it out, is an attitude of repeated sin, a willful disobedience to disobey God. It's not a smart thing. When I first became a Christian, I had this saying, sin is stupid. That's good theology. Sin is stupid. Obedience is very intelligent. Sin is just plain stupid, because it destroys you and destroys everybody around you. And in Psalm 51, remember after David had committed adultery and willfully sinned and was supposed to be out at war as the king, and he not only committed adultery and got this woman pregnant, but then he had her husband killed. I mean, that's pretty willful. This is the man after God's own heart, which gives us all hope, doesn't it? But in Psalm 51, he hits it right on the nail, just like we talked about last week. He said, "For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise." And this in Psalm 51 is speaking about his escapade with Bathsheba. So it's very important that we don't willfully sin. It's not smart to do that. After we have received the knowledge of the truth, there's no longer a sacrifice if I willfully walked away from God right now, having known everything I've known for 41 and a half years and had the grace of God in my life and all the gracious things that he's done, I would be a fool to willfully sin. And I've known some people in my past in the last 41 and a half years. I've counseled with them. I've been involved with them. They've committed sins as leaders that have affected the body of Christ. And it's been like an incredible living object blessing for me. And I said, "God, I would rather be struck with lightning than have do this to people." See, your sin doesn't just affect yourself. It affects everyone around you. But you know what? Every one of them said to 100%, every man and every woman I've talked to that's fallen into public, well-known sin as a leader, every single one of them to 100% told me this: "I got so busy involved in ministry, I got so busy doing things that I lost my time to be alone with the Lord. The only time I was in the Bible was to study for my messages." At one point, a few years ago, I heard the average pastor pray 7 minutes. Shocked me. I'll tell you, I'm not average. Because I know, you know what? People say, "Why do you pray so much?" Because I know what I'm like without him. And I desperately need him. And God is a holy God. And I take what I do very important, not lightly. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God, isn't it? So it says it right here. And there's a fearful expectation of judgment and fire indignation. And we don't hear enough preaching about the judgment seat of Christ, or that God is a just God, that every man will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. How many remember Holy Hubert? Who's old enough to remember Holy Hubert? Raise your hand. Come on, a few of you. Remember Holy Hubert? Guy has teeth knocked out, had freckles. He said he was God's ugliest man. That's what he used to say. I remember when I was going through my nervous breakdown, walking across campus, he had this big sign about as big as that with red flames going up saying, "Where are you going to spend eternity? Hopefully not in hell." I said, "I don't want to think about that right now. I got enough problems." But you know what? God used that to influence me in my salvation. He got his teeth knocked out, and he was a fiery kind of John the Baptist. I just read an article they had in a newspaper about him. All the lives he affected, about 3.5 million people. But he was unashamed to go and tell people judgment's coming. And now we're just trying to be nicey-nicey to everybody. You know, we need to tell people there's a judgment. There's a holy God that there. I shudder to think what's going to happen when people without Christ are going to stand before him, before his Shekinah glory and his holiness. And, you know, when it says the seraphim have to cover their eyes because they can't even look upon him or behold him, you know what? It's amazing. They have to cover their eyes because of the glory that's around his throne. And one day people are going to be naked before that with no covering. I mean, it makes me shudder. It makes me realize, don't ever be afraid to witness to somebody. It's really important that we witness to people. In Moses' day, anyone who rejected Moses thought, it said, you know what? Back in those days, you died without mercy. There was no mercy. And it says right in Deuteronomy chapter 17, 2-7, speaking of this passage, it's quoted by the author of Hebrews, who I think was Paul, but we'll find out if I'm wrong when I get to heaven. "If there is found among you within any of your gates, which the Lord your God gives you, a man or woman who's wicked in the sight of the Lord your God and transgressing his covenant, who has gone and served other gods and worshiped them, either the sun or moon or any of the host of heaven, which I have not commanded," so they were in idolatry, "as it is told you and you hear of it, then you shall inquire diligently. And if it is indeed true and certain that such an abomination has been committed in Israel, then you shall bring out to your gates that man or woman who has committed that wicked thing and shall stone to death the man or woman with stones. Whoever is deserving of death shall be put to death on the testimony of two or three witnesses. He shall not be put to death on the testimony of one witness. The hands of the witness shall be the first against him to put him to death, and afterward the hands of all the people. So you shall put away the evil from among you." So one of the reasons God brings judgment is it puts away evil from among us. You know what? It was a good thing that Adolf Hitler's life ended. You know when God brings judgment? When there's nothing else he can do. God brings judgment when he's extended his grace and mercy over and over and over, and people so willfully reject it, there's nothing else he can do. And many of the times that God brings judgment to evil is because he's going to stop evil from getting beyond what it could do to. He's a holy God. He's a wise God. He's a just God. It tells you right there in this passage one of the reasons why he does. You know, it's amazing. Remember when they were men were groping for the door handles, it said they were trying to have a relationship with men, and God struck them blind. And in their blindness, it said they groped for the door handles to try and continue their sin. That's willful sin. I mean, you think if you got struck blind by God, it might get your attention. It might stop you from doing what you know you're not supposed to be doing. Willful sin is a very evil and wicked thing. How much worse punishment, it says, if you trample the Son of God underfoot and you count the blood of Jesus, the blood of a covenant, a common thing, and if you insult the Spirit of grace, you can bring, and I can bring insult to the Spirit of grace. See, we've made grace license in many places. Grace is never licensed to sin. It says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound in Romans 6? And Paul's answer is, God forbid. And I've had people say, well, I'm going to go and sin this week, but I'm going to ask you to forgive me now before I do it. I go, you're presuming that's not the grace of God. That's foolishness. It also says in the Bible, the grace of God teaches us to deny ungodliness, to live righteously and soberly in this present world. Some people think more is going to happen through their death than the death of Jesus. You know what? You're going to appear before God the way you die. So it's really, really important that we understand and let people know, you know what? He is a holy and a righteous God. It's incredible, and it's very arrogant to think, you know, it's even greater than breaking laws. It'll be a worse judgment for those that would do despite to the blood of Jesus. And the Bible says here that vengeance is mine, I will repay. The Lord will judge his people, and we need to tell people it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. If you're not right with him and you're not under the blood of Jesus, it's a fearful thing. He's a holy God. Remember David? He decided at one time he was going to trust in his armies, and he started to count his armies. Remember, his one leader said, please, David, don't count them. And he did, didn't he? And what did God say? He took Gad the prophet, and he went to David. You'll find it. Don't have time to read it in this service, but 2 Samuel 24:12-14, he said, you can choose one of these three things. And he said, I'd rather fall into the hands of God than the hands of men, because God is merciful. Thank God, in his judgment, he always remembers mercy. Thank God, it's better to fall into his hands than the hands of men. And if you're sinning, if you know you're doing something willfully, I have one word for you. Repent. Yeah. It's the first word of the gospel. You don't even hardly hear it anymore. What did he preach on the day of Pentecost? Repent and be baptized for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the Holy Ghost. What did Jesus do when he came in Mark 1? As soon as he began to preach, he said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. We don't even hardly hear repentance anymore. Or someone starts to repent and people stop them from repenting. You go, oh, you're under condemnation. No, they're under conviction. The Holy Spirit's actually convicting them. Don't work them out of the Holy Spirit's conviction on their life by you trying to be a nicey-nicey person. Let the Holy Spirit do what only the Holy Spirit can do. Did you read of the old revivals? When people would fall on the ground and sometimes weep for 2 or 3 or 4 days in such a spirit of conviction, but boy, when they got up, they were changed. I mean, do you read some of those days? Sometimes when Charles Finney would ride into a city, the spirit of conviction would fall. Wouldn't you like to ride into a city and have the spirit of conviction fall on the whole city so they can get saved? But we don't preach repentance hardly. I do, but you know what? I don't probably preach it enough. But when I ask people to get saved, I say, you need to repent. You need to turn from going your own way. Your life's no longer, you're getting saved. Your life's no longer your own. You don't get to call the shots anymore. Getting saved is getting saved. It's turning from your sin and being your own boss and doing what you want and willfully going your own way to say, I'm going to go your way and do your will. We don't hear that very much. We hear, oh, God is so great. He loves everybody. You've got so much potential. You know, they don't tell you you're going to go to a cross. It's like Joseph Garlington says, yes, from glory to glory, but they don't tell you it's hell in the hallways. And you're going to have to lay down your life. And you're going to have to take up your cross and follow Jesus. And you're going to have to realize that your life's no longer your own. You're not big boy anymore, a big girl. You're little boy and little girl. And you're totally yielded to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we sing songs like, I surrender all. Do we really surrender all? Is it all his? That's being all in. God's judge and he's holy. I got to hurry. And he loves us, so he warns us. Thank God for his warnings. Aren't you glad God warned you? Before I got saved, I had four dreams. Two I went up and two I didn't. I tell you, that made me not sleep for a few nights. That made me think about God when I realized I didn't go up two times in the rapture. Two times I did. I was glad for the two times, but I thought, man, this is not good odds. I wasn't real smart back then, but I knew that wasn't good odds. And then he goes from the words of warning to great words of encouragement to these people who are under tremendous persecution. Can I tell you something? We're going to face a lot more persecution. You think people are angry now? It's nothing to what's going to come on the earth. It's going to cost some people, maybe in this room, their life to follow Jesus. I don't say that lightly. I don't say that to scare. I just say that's a reality. People all over the world, there's more people being martyred in our human lifetime than there has been in all the past hot lifetimes. People are really laying down their life for their faith. I was reading a book Andy gave me this week about my hero and about all the struggles he went through in China and watching his family members be beaten and tortured. Still remembers the effects of it. You never forget those things. But God wants to encourage us in the midst of all this. He encouraged them in their sufferings. He said, and they were illuminated. They endured a great struggle with sufferings. They were made spectacles. They were made reproaches. And by their tribulations and reproaches, they were made spectacles. It's very humbling sometimes when you go and meet some of those people and you just see them weep and say, I am so humbled to be God's servant. Without him, I'm nothing. But now we've raised up in America the cult of personality. If you come and hear my preaching, my 9 hours of anointed preaching, then you meet some of these heroes of the faith in other nations. And when you look at them outwardly, there's no sign that they have any flash or hype. But you just get around them and something, I get around some of them, I start to weep uncontrollably. Because they carry something, that, there's a glory on them. There's a glory that's released on people that have truly been persecuted. They've really laid down their life. I mean, the man I'm reading about has been in prison 7 times in his life. The last time was for 7.5 years in China. We had a man here a number of years ago that came from China. For 20 years, he was in prison for his faith. You know what he volunteered for? He volunteered to clean the human cesspools. He would go into his armpits into human waste. And you know why he volunteered? Because he could be alone with Jesus for the whole day. And when he came into this church, and he said, you know what I sang every day? How many would you sign up for that duty? Oh, the revival, I'll sign up for the revival. And picture yourself up to your armpits in human excrement, cleaning out that 12 hours a day. You know what he did every day? He would sing this. He'd say, thank you, Lord, I can be alone with you. Thank you that you gave me this great job. And he would sing, I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear calling in my ear, the Son of God reposes. And he would sing that every day as he walked through the human cesspools. I don't know about you, but I like to listen to people like that. Now, we're going to be going into the glory realm this week, and then we're going to go into the greater glory. My God, you scare me. One of the young men I mentored goes, Pastor, how many levels of glory is there? Some of those guys are going to new levels every week. Is there like 147 realms? You don't hear them talk about taking up your cross and dying to self. But boy, they're in the glory realm. We need to preach repentance and holiness and righteousness. And what the Word of God says, it's not being preached. But you know what? If you preach through the whole Bible, you gotta stop there and say, this is real, this is reality. You know what? I wonder if the American church is going to be ready for the great persecution that's going to come on the Christians all around the world. I wonder if we're really going to be ready. And they realized, you know what? We've suffered. Yes, we even had compassion on the author of the Hebrews' chains. But they realized they had an enduring possession, that they had a treasure in heaven that was far greater. They even were joyful that all their possessions were stripped away because, you know what, when I was reading this book and he said we had nothing, you know what he did? He killed moles. He trapped moles and sold mole meat to be able to sustain his family. How would you like to be a mole farmer? I can't even catch one. I wouldn't be getting any money. I've tried stuff. I don't know. I heard Travis is really good at catching moles. Travis here today? Travis is really good. If you need moles, find Travis. He's one of the bass players. He's really good at it. He even enjoys it. But he sold moles. To sustain his family, he killed moles and went and sold them in the market for his family to be able to eat. They were beaten and tortured. They were mocked and humiliated. They put dunce caps on them and people would beat them. Some of them got beat to death. That's what they've grown up. People say, why is there a revival in China? Why is there a revival? Because they've been persecuted for years and years for their faith. They've laid down their lives. They've been beaten. They've been tortured. They've been killed. Some of them for just naming the name of Jesus. All around the world that's happening. But you know what? We've got something to live for and something to die for. His name is Jesus. And they were encouraged to be confident. He said, don't cast away your confidence like a garment. Your confidence and your hope has great reward. You know what? There's great reward. You can be confident that God's going to see you through every test, every trial. And yes, you endure. But it says after you've endured, guess what? And after you've done the will of God, you'll receive the promise. So fun to read this book and now know that he's... You know how many people? He started his church with his mother and his sister in a home after he killed the moles. You know how many people in his church today, they believe? Say amen. 15 million people. Most of you probably never heard his name. You've never seen him on TBN or CBN or on the Glory Hour. But from mole rancher to 15 million people in his Fong Cheng Fellowship. And you know, when my wife and I and Andy and some other people, Lance Walnut, were sitting across the table for him, and I realized when I asked if he was still alive, and the lady told me it was him next across the, and when he looked at me and through the interpreter said, he would like you to pray for him. I wanted to fall off my chair. And I said, we would all like him to pray for us. And she said, no, he wants you to pray for him, and he wants you to come and teach his people. You know what? You can ask Andy. When I started to pray, I didn't pray much. I just started bawling like a baby. How are you going to pray for somebody like that? That's like praying for Moses. Oh, yeah, we need to come and pray for Moses. We need someone to come pray for Moses. Oh, we need someone to come pray for Abraham. We need someone to lay hands on the Apostle Paul. I don't know about you, but I'm not getting in the line. I'm getting way in the back. You hear what I'm saying? We have such a cult of personality in the United States. We're attracted to all the flash and the glimmer and the glamour. I was with Richard, and he said, the Lord spoke to me and said, he's going to bring down the cult of personality in the United States. And you don't even know some of these Chinese believers that have risked their lives, that have been tortured for their faith. I remember one lady I heard of where they literally burned her tongue out of her mouth. She wouldn't quit preaching, so they burned her tongue and just took her tongue out. You know what happened? They put her in a prison, and all the prisoners got mad at her because she was so joyful. And she wrote the name of Jesus in Chinese, and the Holy Spirit fell in the prison. All 200 prisoners got saved. Hebrews chapter 11 says there's people like that that the world's not even worthy of. And we just like people that, oh boy, look at their, oh, and the way they preach. And, you know, we're gonna have a seminar and teach how to preach the massive and, you know, get the things going up here and the lights and the smoke and, woo! God help us. God help us. God help us. What happened to humility and integrity? What happened to people taking up their cross and following Jesus? And being servants and taking the back seat and the back door and the last place? God help us. One of the keys to your victory is courageous endurance. After you've done the will of God, guess what? You'll receive the promise. You know what? The world's waiting to hear the truth. They know when the church is full of phony baloney. But boy, when they see the real thing, they know the real thing. That's what they're waiting for. So a little while, Jesus will be coming, and he that tarries will tarry. He quotes Habakkuk 2. I always love it when people say, oh, that's the Old Testament. I say, have you read the New Testament? Most of the New Testament's the Old Testament. Revealed through the blood covenant of Jesus Christ. So God takes no pleasure in us drawing back, and we are those who believe in the saving of the soul. And some are destined to perdition, it says. That's a wasted life. My grandson Justice was sitting by us at the talent show. They had 40 acts. We got there and it says, 40 acts in an elementary talent show? We're going to be here like all night. And one little boy got up and did his whole act like in about 7 seconds. And you know how innocent little kids are. Just as he's seven, he goes, "That was a waste." And I said, "Justice?" And he goes, "Well, I'm serious. That was a waste." I mean, you know, they just tell it like it is. They're not there to win friends and influence people. And I said, "You know what perdition is? It's really what a waste. Someone that God created for his glory and honor has wasted their life with their own selfishness, with doing their own thing, going their own way when they could have been God's son or daughter. God help us." You know, we can take up our cross and follow Jesus. And it says that, I love this one last thing, and I'll close with this. Who believed to the saving of their soul. You were not only saved by faith, by grace through faith. You're not only saved by faith, but you live by faith. And if you say, "Well, I'm not doing real good with my faith, or I'm struggling," I've got good news. Faith comes. Faith comes when you hear the word of God. And the more you hear it, the more you apply it, the more you break those lies off your life. And if you're be like it in Mark 8, chapter 8, verses 34 to 38, when he had called his people to himself with his disciples, all he said to them, "Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man also will be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." When was the last time you had that verse preached on television? "Oh, well, we'll lose our ratings. We'll lose our offerings. Maybe you need to lose more than that. Maybe you need to lose your life." Jesus became of no reputation. We asked the prayer team to come up. We can fellowship with his sufferings and those that suffer. And I'm going to encourage you to meet some of those people in the world that have been tortured for their faith. You can be confident in God and you can endure to the end. You can endure to the end. And John, as you endure, God's going to do something for you, John. And we're praying for you. And after you've done the will of God, you're going to receive the promise. We go through things. We endure things. Sometimes things shift, and we're in warfare and battle, and we're in a spirit and age of lawlessness. We need to walk by grace. I need the prayer team to come up right away. I need all of you to come up here real quick. I remember when we were at one of our FCA conferences, and Connor Conlon, who took over for David Wilkerson, an unknown preacher in Canada that had 200 people, is the person David Wilkerson picked to take over his ministry. He's a powerful preacher. He doesn't mince any words. He's asked to come and speak. He's asked to come and speak right before 9/11 at a fundraiser for African children. And something happens as he's praying, and God says, "I don't want you to take an offering for African children. I want you to warn people that will be in the meeting." There was people that were drinking in the meeting, businessmen and people. They said the Holy Spirit got so strong in the room that people were holding their glasses to drink like this up to their mouth and were not drinking the whole time he was speaking. And he spoke a message of, "I don't know what's going to happen, but some of you within the next few days are going to be faced with death. And some of you are going to have a momentary time before you know you're going to know you're going to die. And before you die, I want you to remember this. You need to call out to Jesus." And he argued with God and said, I've been invited to raise money for this African children's group. And he said, "I want you to warn people." I forget the exact number. I think it was 30-some people that were sitting in that room died in the Twin Towers. But he had enough guts to stand up when he was invited to raise money. The Holy Spirit said, "There's going to be people sitting in that room that will face an eternity." He didn't look very foolish, though, after the Twin Towers happened. And 30-some of the people that he spoke to, I wonder how many of them cried out in their last breath because someone was faithful to preach the truth. Someone was faithful to say, "You're going to face death." Someone was truthful and not afraid enough of what people would think. Now, God took care of the African Children's Fund. He blessed it really good. But you know what? We need people that will stand up and speak the truth. And some of you are being stopped from speaking the truth because, you know what? Lies have held you back. Lies have held you back. Things that have been spoken over your life by authority figures, by people. And those lies, you know what? The devil wants to, he wants to speak the lies in hate. Jesus wants to speak the truth in love. And some of these people are going to speak truth into your life. They're going to get you out of the lies line and put you in alignment in God's line with the truth. And we're going to break those things off your life. Some of you have had pronouncements and things that haunt you all the time. Some of you maybe you've never even told people. You faked it. You know, I was good at faking it for years. I just was quiet. If you're quiet and don't say much, people think you're really smart. I was just really afraid. So I kept everything inside. But then God got a hold of me and convicted me of my sin. Father, we thank you today for your word that it's so true. Forgive us as a nation when we've just wanted to hear the good things and we've not listened to the warnings and we've not repented and turned from our sin. Lord, the first message that was spoken by Paul was repent. The first message that was spoken by Peter was repent. Jesus, when you came in Mark, you said repent. And on and on and on, all through the ages, Lord, the first word of the gospel is repent. Repent and believe the gospel. And I pray that we would turn from any way that's not your way. And I pray that the truth would set people free today. They would be released. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If you say, Pastor, I've never received Christ, it'd be a good day to receive Christ and turn to him. And receive the gift that he gave you by dying on the cross and shedding his blood and rising from the dead. He left heaven to come down and feel your pain, to go through what you go through. And he took not only your sin, but the sin of the whole world upon himself at the cross. He literally became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. But, you know, it'll cost you everything to follow Jesus. It'll cost you everything. It means you give him all, you're all in. You're signing your life away. You're sentenced to death, and you're also sentenced to life. But when you die, in the kingdom you live. When you lose your life for his sake, you'll have so much life, you'll have to pinch yourself sometimes to figure out what's going on. I can say for 41 and a half years, that's been my testimony. His life gets better and better. Is there anyone say, that's me, Pastor? I need to turn. I need to receive Christ. I'm not a believer, but I want to be a believer today. Anyone raise their hand, just lift it high and wave it at me real quick. Let me see it. If that's you, you want to turn your life over to Jesus. Is there anyone? You might all be believers. Thank you. Is there anyone else? Thank you. I see your hand, young lady. Thank you. Is there anyone else? You say, I want to repent. I want to turn from going my own way. I want Jesus to be my Lord. I want to be forgiven. I want to live the life that God intended for me to live. It'll cost you everything, but you know what happens nowadays? To this generation, they sell everybody a bill of good about your potential and you can do whatever you want and your dream is not big enough, but they don't tell you how hard it's going to be. I had a friend that did a study of every graduation a few years ago, and they all said, you can reach your fullest potential, you can dream whatever, nobody can stop you, but you know what? Nobody told them the price it would pay. And they told them about all their heroes, but they didn't tell them the price they paid. They didn't tell them all the struggles and the hardships they went through to be an overnight success 40 years later. Ray Kroc started McDonald's at 61 years of age. He was a broken man. His wife just gave away a few years ago $20 million to the Salvation Army. McDonald's has been a little bit successful, whether you like their food or not. And God's ready to use people that are willing to pay the price. Is anyone else? You raise your hand. I'm just asking, when I call people forth, that young lady would just come up. If you would, where's one of the ladies from the evangelism team, the GO team? Is there a lady up here in the front that's on the GO team? Not in this service, oh, right here. So would you just, the young lady that raised her hand, just find this gal right here on the orange at the end. She'll pray with you, all right, right here on the end. God bless you. See, she's not afraid. She's going to get up right now. I didn't even ask her to. She's going to follow Jesus. I'll tell you, this is what it's all about. Let's stand up. If you need the truth spoken, you come right now. There's something in your life that you need to be freed or healed. We're going to declare the word of God over you. And remember, all of the new members, we're going to have a lunch for you in the back. We'll be there in a few minutes. Some of you need the truth spoken over your life. You need to break things, lies off your family that have been spoken by your fathers, your mothers. It's haunted you all your life. It's time to stop haunting you. We're going to speak the truth in love, and there's power in the word of God. There's power to set people free. There's power to make a difference. And this week, take up your cross. If he tells you to go do something, don't argue with him. Don't fight him. Don't think that you're smarter than him. Just do it. The problem is we think too much. Just do what he tells you to do. You come forward. If not, God bless you and have a great week. Keep praying for the Philippine team. They'll be back on Wednesday.